Hi mates, and welcome back to my World of Tanks channel. I'm Antonov2 as usual, and today we'll be taking a closer look at the 110, which is kind of like the Chinese looked at the IS-3 and said, oh, we want one of these too. And then they just got themselves one that made it a bit better in some regards and worse in others. So in the course of this video, we'll be discussing the traits of the 110, looking at its stats, and obviously be comparing it to its peers. Most of all, of course, the IS-3, because they are pretty similar vehicles. I'll be giving you ideas on how to research this tank, its modules, what equipment and crew skills to get, the tactics you should best employ. Then we will take it out for a spin, look at how it performs on the battlefield, and then finally I will give you my opinion on whether this tank is actually better than the IS-3 or whether that is just a myth. So we've got quite a curriculum for today, so let us get stuck right in. So when we have a look at the tech tree, we can see that the 110 is situated here at tier 8 leading up to the 113, and honestly I was really looking forward to getting the 110 because I didn't really like most of the tanks leading up to it. I mean, I guess the IS-2 was alright, but it was just felt like a bit of a worse version of an IS, and I had already played the IS a lot, so although I didn't mind the tank, I was really looking forward to getting my hands on the tier 8. And then obviously it leads on to the WZ and the 113. If we look at the 110's module tree, actually the 122mm D25T, as well as the radio and the engine, will carry over from the IS-2, and you should immediately equip these. Unfortunately, however, before you can upgrade anything else, you need to get the upgraded suspension. And that makes the grind pretty tough on the 110, in my opinion, because the stock turret really is no good, and you want to get this T10 turret as quickly as possible, and until you unlock that, you've got very low survivability, and this 122mm gun is not all too nice at tier 8 either, although the gun is alright I guess, but you really want to get this 100mm top tier 9 gun unlocked. Now, interestingly enough, when you compare the top tier 9 gun with the 122mm gun, you can actually see that it's not all a win when you upgrade to the better gun, and that is because you lose 22mm in caliber. So fair enough, your rate of fire increases, your penetration increases, but your damage decreases by 70 hit points. That's very significant. However, your accuracy and aim time are greatly improved. So overall, I would definitely recommend getting the tier 9 gun, because even if you fire premium all the time using the 122mm, you still have got less penetration than you would have firing premium on the 100mm. And also you should take into account that heat is not really that great for, say, penetrating spaced armor and so on. So really, this gun is just far superior. But it just feels like a bit of a shame that you're missing out on that huge alpha damage. And that is, like, the IS-3 gets that 390 alpha damage, so you might feel a bit cheated there. So now we'll be looking at the stats of the 110, and we'll be comparing it mostly to the IS-3, but I also pulled up the T-32 and Tiger II because they've got also kind of similar guns to the 110 and are pretty popular at tier 8. So first of all, we can see that the 110 stacks up very well when we look at the DPM. It's got the best DPM out of a bunch, one of the best DPMs of all tier 8 heavy tanks, although the Carnarvon has got it beat, obviously. It gets 215mm of penetration, which is alright, I guess, but it's not superb, and you can see that the Tiger II and the IS-3 have got it beaten in that regard, and in my opinion, it felt okay, but it really felt okay, and it didn't feel amazing, you know, it didn't feel really good. And then, obviously, the alpha damage at 320 is, well, it's just not as good as the IS-3's alpha damage at 390, and you really feel the difference. Now, it is similar alpha damage to the T-32 and the Tiger II, but I would really like to have that 390 alpha damage, and it's a difference that you really do feel. And it's something you have to get used to when you change from the IS-3 to the 110. Rate of fire, however, is a lot higher, actually the highest out of any of these tanks, and significantly higher than the IS-3, allowing it to get this almost 200 hit points more DPM. The reload time is basically 3 seconds less in the 110, and one thing that I would like to point out in comparison to the IS-3 though, is that this caliber difference of 22mm means that in the 110 you can only overmatch tanks with about 30mm of armor, while the IS-3 can overmatch tanks with 40mm of armor basically. So that's a kind of almost 10mm difference, and that is pretty significant, especially when engaging lower tier opponents, so I would keep that in mind. Also, the shell velocity is not very good on the 110, so if you know about the bad shell velocity on the T32, you kind of know what you're getting into when you play the 110. The ammo capacity is sufficient, in my opinion, for this tank, and that is something where the IS-3 really struggles, as it only gets 28 rounds, but the 110 with 40 should be enough for most games unless you have to really hyper carry. Now, the soft stats of the gun kind of aren't that great really on the 110. I mean, fair enough, it gets better aim time than the IS-3, but if we compare its aim time to other tanks that use a 320 alpha damage gun like the T32 and Tiger 2, it's actually very lackluster, and the same thing can be said for the accuracy. 0.38 and 0.36 are kind of in the same ballpark. I mean, of course 0.36 is better, but not by that much really, in my opinion. The bloom of the gun is also pretty bad, as you can see right here, when you're moving, and it's the worst of any of these three tanks really, and the elevation and depression angles are pretty bad. Especially, I think 15 degrees of elevation, even that can really get in your way a lot. It gets 1 degree more gun depression for IS-3, but really 6 degrees isn't great either. But obviously 5 on the IS-3 is horrible, but 6 is pretty bad, and you can see that the other two tier 8s here have got it beaten quite significantly. It's the fastest tank as far as top speed is concerned out of this bunch, and the reverse speed is very nice as well for a heavy tank. However, the engine is pretty weak at 580 horsepower, resulting in the power to weight ratio of only 11, so only the Tiger 2 is worse than that, and that kind of gives you an impression of that the IS-3 will be quite a bit speedier, especially if you take into consideration that the terrain resistances are pretty bad on the 110, and worse actually than the terrain resistances for IS-3. So in the end, the IS-3 is actually more speedy, or at least more maneuverable than the 110 is. One thing that I should also point out though is that with 50 kilograms, that's actually a fairly nice weight, and you can do some ramming in this vehicle, so that's just something to keep in mind. Next, we come to a kind of a strong suit of the 110, I'd say, and that's its armor. It's got 120mm of raw frontal armor, and if you look at it, it's extremely well angled. It's got the same kind of pike nose that the IS-3 gets, but it's a lot more pronounced, and that allows you to actually ricochet many guns that would easily penetrate the IS-3. So for example, with a 122mm Soviet gun with 175mm of pen, that will most of the time be able to frontally penetrate the IS-3 with some luck, but it will never go through the 110 if it's facing you straight on. And the turret is also fairly good at 201mm. It is very well angled, but the IS-3's turret is just frontally a bit sturdier. However, the 110 does not get that horrible weak spot at the top of the turret that the IS-3 gets just above the gun, so that's a big advantage. And actually, I'd say that the turret of the 110 is better frontally than the IS-3's turret. However, when we get to the side, it's a bit of a different deal, because the 110 has got a kind of a rounder and higher turret, while the IS-3's turret sides are better, have got a better slope. Actually, the IS-3's sides are more difficult to penetrate than the 110's. Now, armor-wise, I'd say the 110 is probably better than the T32 because of its better hull armor, but worse than the Tiger 2 maybe. The thing about the 110 is that frontally it's amazing, right? But as soon as you angle the tank or you give your enemies your side, you're done for. Your side armor is really bad, and even you can't even really angle the front of your tank because it's got this pike nose, and you basically decrease its angling if you angle it. And that makes it very difficult to come around corners, say, in the 110, because if you drive around a corner, you have to kind of angle your tank, and then enemies will be able to fire shots into the cheek of that pike nose. Now, the hit point pool is pretty impressive at 1550. That will keep you going quite a while. Very respectable hit point pool at tier 8. And also the view range is average at 380, so no surprises there. One thing I should point out maybe is the very low chance of fire of 12%, which is shared with the IS-3, but it's definitely got the edge as far as view range is concerned. So in comparison to the IS-3, we can sum up that it gets kind of similar but slightly worse mobility, slightly better soft stats on the gun, but worse hard stats like penetration and damage. And also the armor is better frontally, but worse if your sides are being attacked or you're being outflanked. So we have spawned on Sacred Valley in a pretty bad matchup. This is a tier 10 game. Fair enough, only 3 tier 10 tanks on each team. 4 on our team, 4 on theirs. Okay, my mistake. Anyway, so this is kind of, could be a bit tough, but I have got a tactic for this kind of a situation. What I'm going to do is I'm going to try, as you can see, most of the enemy heavy tanks have already pushed down the B line, and I've come past this opening here. So I'm going to just wait here for a second to see if this KV-4 makes a move. But he's playing pretty safely there. So what I like to do in this kind of a situation, if I have a lot of tanks up here and I am in a lower tier vehicle that doesn't have much of a chance to engage vehicles like an E-75, an E-100 or a Yak Tiger frontally, what I'm going to try to do now is I'm going to try to flank round, right? This is a very good thing you can do on Sacred Valley to break a stalemate that has developed in this north western corner of the map. So obviously this Carnarvon here is expecting us by now, but he was over-angling a sidearm and I put a shot in, but right there you could see we low-rolled quite significantly, only doing 220 damage. Next shot goes in and 292, and there you can see this gun, when it low-rolls, it is really painful because you just wish you had an IS-3's gun with that massive alpha damage. Anyway, a bit of some pushing going on here. But we wait for the AMX to take a shot, and now we might be able to finish this guy off. Shot the lower glacius, and yes, sure enough. So now we've got kind of an open pathway to take these two tier 9 tanks and the tier 10 E100 in the rear. And I'm going to take out this Yak Tiger here and just continue driving, because we've got these guys here. And this is how easily you could just demolish this entire flank if you manage to flank round. And as you can see right here, the good rate of fire of the 110 really pays off. And this is a situation where I would rather be driving this tank than an IS-3, for the simple reason that those were a lot of shots where I just had to finish off enemies as opposed to do a lot of alpha damage. And in that kind of a scenario, it's better to have a high rate of fire, and the better DPM really pays off if you have the rear of your enemies, like I did right there. So I'm a bit afraid of this Gorilla 15, and now a T-49 splashes on us for 350 damage. So we're kind of stuck here for the time being. Get moving again, and things aren't looking too good for our team here. We're down two tanks, but we've still got two tier 10 vehicles and two tier 9 vehicles, while they've only got two tier 10 vehicles and the rest are tier 8s, so we might stand a fighting chance here. Now I'm a bit afraid of this Object 140, because he could chew me to bits in just like 20 seconds or 15 seconds with that amazing DPM that he has. So he won't really be struggling against my hull armor, but I'm hoping that I can kind of use the terrain here to maybe get an advantage for myself. So I take a snapshot and miss, and although the kind of gun handling on this vehicle is better than on the IS3, this kind of stuff will happen. And right now, honestly, I'd rather be in an IS3, because an IS3 can probably finish off this object 140 in 2 shots, while I will need 3 shots, and that is kind of worse. Although I have better rate of fire, it is a lot worse than just being able to take 2 slow shots at the 140, especially because an IS-3 would also have better chances of penetrating, given its better penetration values. So right there you can see I bounce off the upper glacis of Object 140. He takes a shot at me, penetrates, but I luckily get him in the engine and set him on fire, securing a kill. That was really lucky there. Unfortunately though, I'm really surrounded here. I'd get a shot into the Yak Panther 2, but I've got a Gorilla 15 and a UDES coming round my rear, and I realise, okay, the Gorilla 15 is the biggest threat right here. I need to take this guy out, and I take a shot at him. Oh, please don't. He doesn't have the gun depression. Come on. Come on. And I take a shot, and oh my god, I am so lucky. The Emil, I think, took him out, yeah. So, I got lucky there. Unfortunately, though, the Yak Panther 2 then takes me out in turn. So, that was fairly unlucky there. But still, I think we really helped our team to kind of win this flank, more or less, and go on to win the game. So, because we focused all these enemy tanks on us, and that allowed the rest of my team to clean up, and although we had to sacrifice ourselves, in the end it won us the game. So let's have a quick look at the post-game stats, and then we'll move on to see how this vehicle performs if it's in its kind of native environment, which is a tier 8 game where it can bully the shit out of per tier 7 and tier 6 tanks. So here we go, I actually got an ace tanker for that game, scoring 5,293 experience. I think that was for a times 3 though. We finished top of our team, 1,400 base experience. It's pretty impressive, although we only did 3,350 damage, and that's probably because we were firing at higher tier opponents most of the time. So we fired 14 shots, which 13 hit and 12 penetrated. So that is a fairly good score, but obviously we were engaging at close ranges most of the time too. 3,356 damage is alright, I guess. And we received 10 hits, of which 6 penetrated and 4 didn't. So I think that is pretty impressive, considering that this was a tier 10 game. And if you remember, we bounced shots of, say, that object 140 later on, so that was pretty good. And we were able to block 1,280 damage in total. Not too much assistance damage going on. We got quite a big profit, but I would like to remind you that the ammo on this vehicle is actually pretty expensive at 1,000 a shot. So you have to be a bit careful, especially if you don't hit, because you are paying the same price for your ammunition as you would be on an IS-3, but you fire a lot quicker and do less damage with each shot, so that can be a bit problematic. But anyway, as I promised, now I'll be showing you a tier 8 game, and yeah, let's see how I take enemies apart on Himmelsdorf, hey? So this game, apart from me being happy that I spawned in a tier 8 round, is a real treat, and I just rewatched it, and let me tell you, this is a real nail biter at the end, so stay tuned. Anyway, I am on Himmelsdorf, and I decided to come here first of all because this is really the perfect spot for the 110 usually, because it's a clear kind of alleyway where I figured I could use my frontal armor very effectively. Unfortunately, at the other side, there was a hull down Yak Tiger 8.8, and quite frankly, I immediately decided to switch flanks because there's no way I'm going to be able to dig that dude out anytime soon in this vehicle, because it does not have the penetration, and by the time I had pushed down that flank, he would have had chewed me apart, because his 8.8 millimeter gun, centimeter gun, excuse me, is more than enough to penetrate my frontal armor. So anyway, I find another pretty sweet spot on this map, which is behind this kind of pile of rubble here, and this is very nice because I'm facing my enemies front on, and at the same time hiding my lower glacis behind this pile of rubble. So I'm actually very, very difficult to penetrate right now for my opponents, and that allows me to use my DPM to chew them apart, basically. And as you can see, that IS-6 got to feel the hurt right there. So I'm hoping that these guys are going to be stupid enough to drive out to the open, but it doesn't look like I'm getting lucky. However, there might be a Panzer IV noise on the other side of the building. So I decided to just go for it, and then, however, I spotted Tiger P, take a punt at him, but no way I'm penetrating that frontal armor from this distance. So I just play the waiting game, but it doesn't seem like I'm going to be lucky here, so I just decide to go for it, and maybe I can help my team push around this corner here. I get a bit distracted, and let's see. Oh, there's a Dickamax. Okay, so it's lunchtime, right? And he gets taken out, and you can see this is actually was pretty effective what I was doing here. I just want to pause for a second, because I was aiming in this direction to take out the Dickamax, but was keeping my hull facing towards the KV-5 so that he would still bounce when he hit me, because if I had angled my hull towards the Dickamax, then the KV-5 would have definitely penetrated. And as the Dickamax was not aiming at me, that was pretty prudent of me there, so I just wanted to point that out. That's something you can do, always angle your hull, or not angle, but face your hull in the direction of the opponents who are trying to shoot at you. Now that was very dumb of me what I did there. Somehow I connect snapshot into the Tiger P, but unfortunately I took a hit in return too. So that just shows you how careful you have to be with exposing the sides and yeah, the flank of this vehicle, basically. So right now I'm coming around a corner, and just let me pause here, because you might think this is really bad what I'm doing, and actually it's not perfect, but it's not too bad either, because these enemies here, they cannot actually hit most of my glacius plate that's facing towards them here because of this rubble. So actually it's pretty difficult for them to pen me here, and as you can see, they bounce all the time because this rubble here is in the way of them hitting the side of my hull that is facing towards them, and that means they still have to try and penetrate me the difficult way. Unfortunately, I'm getting sniped by that T-44-100, so I decide to change positions here, take a shot on the move at the T-20, but I missed, unfortunately. And now let's see if we can take out these guys here. So this just shows you how strong the 110 is when engaging lower tier opponents. There's literally nothing these guys can do against me, and I'm just picking them apart one by one. So I'm thinking of going after this T-20 here, but I think he's going to get taken out with this Cromwell, probably. Yeah, there we go. So that's not going to be my fifth kill, but let's look into this IS-6. So I get one shot into his side and finish him off for my fifth kill, but we've still got four enemy tanks left, and they're mostly tier 8 except for the Tiger P, so this will be a pretty tough match to win here. But I'm hunting a Top Gun now, so I'm fairly motivated, you bet. And go around the corner, and there's the Tiger P with his rear towards me, so this is pretty good for me. And I get a shot in and drive on, so that in case he moves, I'll still be able to get shots. But he doesn't even seem to realize that I'm shooting at him, and that's how easily I pick up my Top Gun. But now the next prize is on the line, because there are still three enemy tanks there, and now I've got this Radley Walters medal waiting for me, and I really want to get my hands on that, because I somehow struggle to get Radley Walters. So let's see if it's kind of a bit tricky here, because I am against three tier 8 tanks. I am below half of my health, I'm on a third of my health, and the only allies I have left are two tier 6 tanks. So here's an FCM-50T, and oh yeah, that was really lucky there. We connect the snapshot into his turret. That was a very, very clutch shot, but we pick up our 7th kill, and oh yeah, we also get a shot into the Tiger 2. So he's in one shot range of us, but now this KV-5 here is becoming pretty serious about taking out the Cromwell. And luckily that allows us to put shots into his rear, but unfortunately our Cromwell goes down, and that puts in a 2v2 and a 1v2 against two tier 8 opponents. I've got less health than that KV-5, and really right now I can see the Tiger 8 is probably going to try to flank round, so really I have to engage as quickly as possible here in order to stop them from kind of outmaneuvering me. And unluckily the Tiger 8.8 got into a position already to get a flanking shot into me. However, he is very slow, so now I'm going to engage this KV-5. I'm going to face hug him. He hasn't got the best penetration, and luckily I high roll and take him out, and it's 1v1 now, but I'm on really low health, and if the Tiger 2 high, if a Tiger 8.8 high rolls, he can still take me out. But I really, really want to win this game. I've already got Bradley Walters secure, but that's not enough. I really want to take this win down. And now it's just mind games, right? Like, I don't know what the Tiger 8.8 is going to do. Is he going to come around the left or the right? And if he gets the jump on me, that could be it. So it's just mind games here. And I very carefully push around the corner. And yeah, I spot him. Okay. So luckily, he didn't get the jump on me here. Let's see if we can take him out. But this is pretty dangerous. There's no real way I'm going to be able to engage him this way if he's held down behind the rubble, because his superstructure is just so strong. This was fairly risky what I did here, this turn exposing my rear. Luckily he wasn't in a position to shoot at me, otherwise that could have ended the game right there. But this is just, I hope that I kind of go hold down, and sure enough I can. He hits my tracks, I repair, and yes, I take him out. So that was a real nail biter, I thought. But I still think this showcased a lot of good tactics you can use in your 110. So first of all, always keep your hull facing towards your opponent. Do not engage enemies that you just have got no chance of penetrating, like this Tiger 8.8 at the beginning when he was hull down there. And then just open up a new flank. Keep your hull facing towards the fire, face hugging against the KV-5. I thought that was showcased very well too here. Basically there was nothing he could do against me, no place he could penetrate, and I could just take him apart. So that was a very perfect example of how you can deal with those kind of tricky situations by using tactics that favour you and your 110. So let's have a quick look at the post-game stats, and then I'm going to give you my final review and opinion on the 110. So probably unsurprisingly we got an ace tanker there, but I was very, very glad to pick up the Radley Walters, the top gun, and I think this is a steel wall and a high caliber, so that was very, very nice. And we finished top of our team with 1761 experience, 9 kills and 6185 damage. So I think this shows you how brutal the 110 can be in the lower tier game. We fired 25 shots, of which 23 connected, 22 penetrations, 6200 damage almost, received 19 hits, of which only 5 penetrated. That's ridiculous, and just shows you how ineffective lower tier guns really are against this tank. We blocked more than 3600 damage, that's more than double our hit point pool. And although we performed so well, we almost lost money in this game, although to be fair we weren't using a premium account. If we had been, we would have run a profit. I think this game just really showed how amazing the 110 can be if it gets to the right kind of situation. But then again, it can also be pretty bad, you know, if you are engaging enemies that just do not care about that good armor you have and can just brutalize you basically. So it's got its pros and cons, right? Speaking of pros and cons, let's have a look at what I think finally about the 110 and my verdict at it. And what a transition, right? So yeah, the 110, I like it, but quite honestly, I'll just say it out, I think the IS-3 is better in most situations. Now The IS3 is kind of, it's faster, and honestly, I like its gun more, just because it's got more penetration, more alpha damage, just more raw kind of power. So I would say the IS3 is still on the throne of, you know, being the best tier 8 heavy tank out there. That being said, though, I think the 110 has still got its kind of niche, and that is facing lower tier opponents. I think that in the kind of a game like we just saw right there, the last game, I would have a lot rather been in a 110 than in an IS3, because it's got the better DPM, it's got better frontal armor, and that just gives you so much more effectiveness if you are top tier. Unfortunately though, obviously you are not always top tier. Most of the time you will be in a tier 9 or a tier 10 game, and that is when you really want to have that extra penetration, that extra damage of the IS-3, because the armor just doesn't count for that much. So yeah, that's still, the 110 was a lot of fun to play, and I'm going to miss it. I'm going to have to sell it to be able to afford my WZ-111, but still, I had a good time with it, and it's, you know, it's a good tank, and as long as you get it into a match where you're top tier, you can definitely rule the battlefield with it. So that was all for my review today. I hope you enjoyed it, found it informative, and maybe learned something about the 110. If you did, make sure to leave a like below, it would help me out a lot, or maybe even sub to my channel. And thanks for watching, I hope I see you next time, or maybe even for Battlefield. Goodbye.